Alright guys, Tanchcrab here back again today. Haven't enjoyed your Monday so far, and today we're going to talk about this Toronto Ultra Brack situation once again. Crimson6 came out with a tweet a few days ago implying that, well, Toronto Ultra had withheld payment from Brack, a substitute player on their team this entire season long. He then came back with a response. Toronto Ultra then responded yesterday, and Brack came back to that once again, leaving the question open, will the CDL step in here to kind of, resolve this dispute, I suppose, because it's a very interesting situation as it continues to develop. Hope you guys enjoy the video. Like if you enjoy it, subscribe if you are new. As always, I'd greatly appreciate it. It really helps out the channel. Let's hop into things then. So Crimson6 said a few days ago, Ultra forced their full roster of 10 to stay into Toronto, threatening to not pay non-starters if they went home. Despite winning the Toronto home series leading up to champs, Brack, who'd never played on their starting lineup, had to fight Ultra to return home for his grandpa's open heart surgery. There was absolutely no chance he would have ever been subbed in because they just won the event. They still aren't paying me, by the way, a full month's worth of salary. They aren't paying me because I was with my grandpa during a high risk open heart surgery. Now I got to fight through challenges, etc., etc. So this is what came out a couple of days ago. And the Toronto Ultra decided we've got to respond to this, right? Which totally makes sense. And I think they reached out to these guys over at this initial podcast and put like a statement out via their like kind of channel, which is kind of strange. But they make a statement here. We have a duty of care to all our players and staff. That is a responsibility that we take very seriously. While we don't discuss confidential employee matters publicly, we worked with our players and their personal requests during the current and ongoing global pandemic. In several circumstances, paid leave on compassionate grounds was granted to our players while abiding newly enacted laws, international restrictions, and essential travel requirements. Every player and staff member that was required to travel as a result was fully compensated throughout their leave. All of our decisions were and continue to be made with the health and safety of our players and staff at its very core. So this is naturally a bad statement from the Toronto Ultra, kind of the thing you might expect to happen. However, they decided to do a twit longer as well. This is where it really kicked off, right? Because I saw this and I was absolutely mind blown. So they title it The Truth About Brack. Already this seems like a, you know, if you've been on YouTube the last few months, as I'm sure a lot of you have, you'll notice this like The Truth About like dot 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 title has been pretty popular with the YouTube algorithm lately. So it was just really strange to me. Like, are they clickbaiting me into clicking this tweet longer? Like, I don't know what's going on, right? Isn't this meant to be like an official press release, like response to the situation? And typically a lot of organizations nowadays would do this by like a PNG. Like, they just make a graphic with their statement, just put it up on Twitter and it would be signed, or at least like, you know, have someone's name at the bottom who's like a director of operations or something. They can kind of take responsibility for this. It seems like this was put together super quickly. It's not particularly well written. We'll go through it. And just the manner in which it was done does not set yourself up for success, right? Even if Toronto Ultra are completely telling the truth here and their side of the story is exactly the correct one, this is not the correct way to go about it. And this tweet, when I said about, you know, titling one side of the story as the truth, is rarely a recipe for PR success. They got ratioed a bit on this one. So I couldn't believe what I was seeing here. Like, twit longer as well is amateur hour. Like, usually you do it on your own website, right? You might put up a press release or something on your own website and link to that. Or as I said, just make an image that to be available, right? Just really weird to title it this, because first of all, it's never going to be, you know, calling it the truth effectively says what is in this twit longer is 100% factual. There's no way anyone can discredit or, well, you know, interpret anything in a different manner. What we are saying is absolutely 100% guaranteed true, which is never the case in anything, right? The truth always tends to lie between both sides of the argument. So incredible oversight really by Toronto in this one. Don't know who the hell signed this off. And then of course we get into the actual twit longer itself. Twit longer is something that amateur organizations tend to put out to use as these like longer form tweets. And you know, I honestly couldn't believe what I was reading. The truth about Brack. Over the past few days, Toronto Ultra's treatment of its players has been called into question and some allegations have been made that simply do not align with the facts known to us. We are posting this statement to provide our perspective on these false and harmful allegations. We owe this to our players, our fans, our tireless staff, and all those who care about the Ultra. Brack came to us asking to return home to be with his family at a difficult time. We alleviated him from his team obligations to go home on compassionate leave. We want to be very clear that we continue to pay Brack his full salary as a compassionate leave, despite the fact we had no contractual or legal obligation to do so, so that he could be with his loved ones, etc., etc. Interesting, first of all, right? Because Crimson6 the other day was saying that, look, these organizations cannot hold players to a geolocation and say that, look, if you leave this city, we're not going going to pay you. Apparently, Crimson Six were saying that it's in the contracts that they can't do that. But there was another clause that Toronto had tried to put in their contracts, which, did in fact say that. And that was where the lies and deception came in from Crimson Six's side. Here, they're openly admitting that, yes, he went home and, you know, we decided to pay him, but we didn't necessarily have to. And Breck said he was only, like, owed 1 month's salary, right, in that tweet we just looked at a couple of days ago. Some days later, then, he came to us to say he was now ill and indicating he could not return to Toronto. We continued to pay him. Finally, we provided him a very generous time period in which to produce sufficient medical documentation substantiating his illness to help us understand when he might return. We subsequently learned that he had cleaned out his belongings from his residence in advance of leaving Toronto for the family emergency, indicating to us that he never intended to return to his work duties in the first place. So this indicating to us doesn't necessarily mean that Brack told them that he didn't intend to return. It just means that, you know, that was their implication from the fact that he cleaned out his residence, I suppose. But he goes on to explain that in a few minutes' time here. With an unwillingness to cooperate and a significant amount of compassionate leave paid, we could not reasonably keep paying Brack's salary. We're a proud organization, etc., etc. And, you know, at some point the organization had to stand up for itself. So, okay, they give some explanation here. One other thing that rubbed me up the wrong way here was, we believe our contact has been entirely reasonable, even characterized as generous towards Brack. I mean, like, it's not you that gets to decide what's generous. You put out the facts to the public as far as you understand them, and then people get to decide, right? Like, yourself calling it generous seems like you're trying to manipulate public opinion in a sense. So anyway, this is what they come out with. This is the explanation from their side. And then, of course, Brack goes on to produce his own responses. We'll look at it in a second. He initially retweeted this, saying how, you know, he was making it very clear to the Toronto Ultra, playing all these scrims, that he did want to play in the starting lineup if he could, and, you know, was committing to the time. Sim then comes out with this, just saying that, like, the GIF isn't trying to make me throw shade. It's just my face after reading the truth about Brack, which is the most mind-blowing thing about this, to be honest. United Johnson's embarrassment. I mean, Overactive Media, one of the behemoths of the industry. Is this what they present a twit longer, right? Which is honestly unbelievable. Richard Lewis, as I'm sure you guys know, a very prominent esports journalist, says, I do consultancy work for a modest fee, but will give out this lesson for free. If you're a professional organization, don't use twit longer for statements. If you're amateurish enough to do that, never, and I mean never, label your statement as the truth, regardless of what the situation actually may be. So before Brack's reply went out, he did this tweet that says, yeah, they definitely paid me during that time. The last time I got paid was August the 14th. My contract ended September the 13th, so just like any other pro contract that didn't get renewed. So he kind of brings the receipts here showing that he got paid on August the 14th, but not since then. So that's kind of the month's salary he talks about. And yes, that does coincide with what Toronto Ultra said, that they didn't pay him that month's salary after it wasn't clear that he actually did have an illness, and it wasn't clear, like, why he'd moved everything out of his apartment. However, Brack says this was very clearly communicated to the organization, and we'll have a look at his response in just a second. Didn't plan on saying anything, but with Toronto Ultra releasing a statement, I find it necessary to come out and tell my side my story below. And apparently this story has been sitting on the sidelines waiting to be aired for several months now. So, you know, this has just been sitting behind the scenes. So this was always going to come out at some point. But as he says, after going home to see my grandpa, I contracted a staph infection in my nose, and my doctor told me explicitly not to travel back to Toronto. I gave Ultra the doctor's note, seen below, no travel for 14 days. So what it says here, if we just zoom in real quick, staph cellulitis face, advised no, it's classic doctorizing in it, but advised no travel for 14 days till follow up with me. And apparently then he did follow up 14 days later, and the doctor gave him another note to say that, like, you still shouldn't travel yet. And apparently that was also sent to the Ultra, and they had all these details. So within 24 hours of the diagnosis, the organization didn't believe me, and tried to force me to come back to Toronto. So, I mean, like, he's straight up given the receipts, like, this is the doctor's note. I believe there was another one as well that the Toronto Ultra had, and, Crimson Six is saying, and now Brack is also saying, they just didn't believe him about the situation. You know, in order to receive my salary, Toronto Ultra did not pay me, despite providing a doctor's note from a licensed medical professional urging me not to return to Toronto. When I left Toronto, so he explains the first situation about, like, his illness, and exactly why they wouldn't pay him for that situation. They didn't seem to believe him. And then, of course, there's the other indication, as they says, that he wasn't committed to his duties because he removed everything from his apartment. He explains that by saying, when I left Toronto to be with my grandpa, I moved out my furniture. I lived there with my girlfriend, Taylor, and my dog, and we shared a lot of furniture and pet supplies in our apartment. There was only 1 month left in the season. It was much easier for me to move everything out with Taylor's help instead of coming back to Toronto and moving it all myself. I told Toronto about this ahead of time. This certainly makes sense, right? There's 1 month in the season. You're not going to ever play in the starting lineup. You're in a health pandemic. Anything that you potentially need to do content-wise could probably be done from the comfort of your own home, which is what most players are doing right now and most teams are doing right now. So he says, of course, the key thing, right? I told Ultra about this ahead of time. He's saying that they were very much aware, and Toronto Ultra saying, like, yo, what do you mean? The plan was to always come back. I was willing to scrim from home and do any media duties required from home to the best of my ability. Despite my doctor's recommendation against travel, Ultra continued to withhold pay. So that's pretty much his statement. He finishes with, I want to thank a few people from the COD scene, including Crimsix, of course, Attach, and LAG as well, pretty interestingly. Of course, not an organization which he is affiliated with, but yeah, apparently they were significantly involved in the support that they gave to him and his family, which is pretty cool to see. So we'll have to see how that situation develops in the coming days. But yeah, you know, look forward to next season improving what I can do once again. As Crimsix then says on here on the Reddit, there's so much more to it than just what has been described so far. Not as extreme, however, but stuff like players still paying for the internet bill, sips tea. So maybe things will be developing once again in coming days. So there we have it. It's a remarkable story as it sits right now. Toronto bring their side in a very questionable manner. Brack then brings out his side with a couple of receipts attached, and clearly it doesn't look like it's been handled great from either side. There's probably things that Brack could have done differently in terms of communication, but also Toronto seem, yeah, somewhat obstinate in terms of if Brack actually did tell them that some things, which I don't necessarily doubt, then, you know, why have they not acted on that and made that public knowledge, I suppose. That's kind of the downside of calling your statement the truth, because when the other person, when the other party then comes back with some other information, or maybe they interpreted something different, then all of a sudden it's just looking like a PR disaster. So how can Toronto even recover from this? Doesn't necessarily even matter at this point what is true. By the way they framed their opinion, the public's, you know, mind is effectively made up, I suppose. But as always, I'm very intrigued to hear your thoughts in the comment section below. Thank you guys for watching the video. Thank you for making it this far. If you did enjoy it or learn something new, I'd greatly appreciate a like down below. It really helps out the YouTube algorithm, helps YouTube know you like this content. Other people like you may enjoy it too, and push it to new audience and grow the Call of Duty community. I'll be back here every single day with more content just like this. Thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.